Let's all give Jesus a hand clap right now. He is worthy. Amen. Amen. You may take your seats. Hallelujah. How many people believe the word of God is true? Thank you, Lord Jesus. We're all in the same place in one accord. Amen. And the word of the Lord tells us that if two of us agree together as touching, we will have what we ask, what we desire of him. He says that if two or three gather together in his name, he is in the midst. That means he's here. Amen. And if he's here, it doesn't matter what we feel. It doesn't matter if we like the atmosphere, the surroundings, the worship, the leading, the people that we see. Nothing matters. His presence is here. Amen. And every time that Jesus comes, he comes with purpose. For this purpose was the Son of God manifested. Amen. That he might destroy.
Yes.
Now we got one in the house. Amen. That he might destroy the works of the devil.
Amen.
Give Jesus a hand clap right now. Amen. I want to thank Pastor Jose and Estela, Pastor Estela. And I want to thank the worship leader and the worship team. I want to thank you so much, brother in the Lord, for that beautiful communion. Amen. We do it in remembrance of him. And we must remember that he died on the cross of Calvary. And he took our grief and our sorrows. And by his stripes, we are healed.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. If there's anybody that has sickness or disease in this place, right now is the moment. This is that we must remember. Call into remembrance in the context of Hebrew scripture is to mutter or to continually declare.
Hallelujah.
I am healed. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. And so we need to continually mutter truth. We must continually declare truth. We must continually, vociferate truth. Somebody say amen, hallelujah.
Amen.
I'll find out what that means later. But anyway, I would thank you so much, Pastor, for having us. And of course, I want to acknowledge a very wonderful personal friend, Pastor Angie Ho from Penang, Malaysia. Our current host, Mr. Jeffrey and Karen Peters. Amen. Thank you, Lord. And of course, every one of you, thank you for being here. Some of you guys I've seen before. Amen. And so it's good to be here. It's good to be in the house of the Lord. I want to share some things that are relatively intimate and personal to me, but they are very powerful, very transforming. And I do it in hopes that it will affect your life and that it will change your life in some way and always for the better. Amen?
Amen?
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. And so, anyway, my name is Cornelio Perez, or as we say back home, Cornelio Longoria Perez de San Angelo, Texas. Anyway. Sometimes I have to take two breaths to say that, but anyway, it has come out. My first name was given to me by divine appointment. When my mother was a child, she called upon the Lord to find out what my name was going to be. She remembered a sermon that she heard when she was 10 years old, and the sermon was on Cornelius, the righteous centurion. Hallelujah. And she remembered that I was the last of seven, and so she remembered it at a later age in her life, but she never forgot that name. And when I was coming along, she remembered it and she said, that's his name. Cornelius or Cornelio literally means the horn of power.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Hallelujah. And my surname, of course, is Perez, P-E-R-E-Z, or it's spelled various ways. But my ethnic roots are Jewish. We are from the tribe of Judah. And on my mother's side, we are indigenous of the Americas, Apache. on my mother's side. Amen. And so I'm tribal on both ends. Hallelujah. Amen. And so if you mix somebody that has Jewish blood and an Apache, this is what you get. Give Jesus a hand clap. Amen. I got saved, and I want to share this as an introductory note to so that you can know who's talking to you. I am of myself of no count, doesn't matter. What really matters is who we represent. We represent the Lord Jesus Christ. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
We are ambassadors of Jesus Christ. Amen. We represent another kingdom that is not of this world. Amen. And so I was born premature. I was 6 months when I was born. And I was born fighting, as you can imagine. And they kept me in an incubator for 3 months. And they tried to, you know, nourish me and get me to develop and stuff like that. But after 3 months, the doctor gave up. And he just told my mother, take him home. If he survives, it'll be by his own sheer will to live. And as you can see, I could eat my brothers under the table. I was always the last one to get off the table. Amen. But anyway, I was born fighting for my life. I was born premature, but God had a purpose. Somebody say, God had a purpose. God always has a purpose. He always has a plan. And if you're given to struggles and it seems that everything that you get in your life, you have to fight for it, chances are that God has got a purpose for your life that the enemy is opposing with everything that he's got. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Amen. He manifested that with Moses when he tried to kill all the children in Egypt that suspecting the deliverer. He did it with the Lord Jesus Christ when Herod had a bunch of people killed trying to stop God's purposes and plans. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Say, I'm still here.
I'm still here.
Amen. Give Jesus a hand clap. Amen. I want to declare to you right now that none of you is here by chance. Every one of you is here by divine appointment. Amen. If the enemy could have snuffed you out, he would have done it by now. But he cannot. That's why you're still here. Come on, give Jesus a hand clap. Amen. Hallelujah. And so, anyway, I grew up, and of course, you know, as in the temptation of the Lord, it says that the Lord was tempted 40 days and 40 nights in the wilderness. And in verse 13, it says that after that, the devil leaveth him and for a season. Amen. At the age of 4, the enemy came back, and my father died as a result of a car accident. It was due to inebriation. My father and my 2 uncles were drinking. If you want to know, I have an enmity against the damnable spirit of alcohol, because that damnable spirit of alcohol killed my father. I was left without a father at the age of 4. And some people say, aren't you being legalistic? No, I'm being real. When my father died, it was not a legality. It was a real experience. And I was left fatherless at the age of 4. But it's okay. Because later, when I got saved at the age of 23, the Lord manifested divinely to me. I was reading the scriptures in Psalm 68 in verse 5. And as I was reading the word, there's a verse there that says that God is a father to the fatherless. Hallelujah. And he is a helper of the widows. And so when I read that verse, it jumped out at me. This is known in Christian jargon or scriptural context as rhema. That scripture became alive. At that instant, when it jumped out at me, and God said to me, and I had my life flash in front of me in an instant, the Lord said, the day that your father died, I took up your cause. Come on.
Amen.
Come on, give him a hand clap right now. Amen. He said, I took up your cause, and in an instant I could see all the times, because I had more times that I can count on my hands and fingers, the times that I was this close to death. I should not be here, but God came through. Drunkenness, drug addiction, violence, accidents, you name it. I went through them all, but the Lord preserved my life. Because God had a plan. Say, God has a plan.
God has a plan.
Amen. None of you is here by chance. I'm telling you, as God lives, you're here because God has appointed a time and a place for you. There's a purpose and a plan for every one of your lives. Amen. And so, because my father died, I went into a terrible life of sin. I started drinking at an extremely young age. I started smoking shortly thereafter, and I started using drugs. All of this happened before the age of 10. And at the age of 11, you would think that things would get better, but I saw the devil face to face. He appeared to me, and I saw him face to face, and he said to me, he said, you come to me. You belong to me. And one of my problems as a young man was rebellion. I had a terrible spirit of rebellion. I could not suffer or abide authority. It's just the way he said it. He said, you belong to me, come with me. And I rebelled against him. And the more we contended in this situation, then he just became extremely mad. His face changed right in front of me. And it began to deform right in front of me. It began to melt right in front of my eyes. And then he just vanished. It was at the age of 11 years old. You would think that I would see the light, but I didn't. I just kept on going in that same direction. The Lord blessed my life with a musical gift. I used to sing, and I was raised in the Mexican culture. So I used to sing all the Mexican classic love songs. And so that opened a lot of wonderful doors to parties and all this kind of stuff. And more alcohol than I could consume, more drugs that I could use. And needless to say, it just kept on getting worse and worse and worse. Then at the age of 23, I walked into a church. I didn't have a repentant heart. I didn't have any noble intentions. I went there because I saw a beautiful girl in church. Somebody say, ooh. I followed a beautiful girl into church, and she wouldn't have any of it, so I got mad at her in church. Yeah. Anger is in the church. And so I got mad at her, and I started paying attention to the preacher. And at the end of his message, he made a challenge to anybody that wanted to receive the Lord. I ran up to the front. Oh, by the way, I was drunk. And I was under the influence of drugs. And I was driven by a spirit of lust, no end. And so I ran up to the front, and the man of God said, get on your knees. I got on my knees, and he said, repeat after me. And he prayed a simple sinner's prayer. Lord, I repent of my sins. Cleanse me with your blood. And come into my heart. Be my Lord. That was the prayer. It was all of 10 to 15 seconds of it. Oh, I had no clue what I was doing. The reason why I make note of this is because the word of the Lord says that all things are possible to them that believe.
Amen.
Amen. Not to them that understand.
That's right.
Amen.
Hallelujah. So many times we want to understand everything before we believe, before we accept it, before we can go along with the program. No, don't do that. The word of the Lord says, all things are possible if you simply believe. And then in the book of Acts, he took it to another level. He said, only believe. The key to receive everything that God has for you is simple act of belief. Belief is a simple act of our will. I choose at this moment to believe, period. Amen. I did that. I share all this to share this very personal experience that happened to me. I prayed that prayer, and instantly within my being, I had a tangible experience where I just began to feel this intense conflict in my belly. And it was just like a battle, like a war going on. And it just rose up within me and became more and more intense. And when it got to my throat, it just erupted like a volcano. And let me tell you what happened next. All this to say this, that the Lord instantly, in that instant, the Lord completely delivered me. He completely delivered me of nicotine, alcohol, drug addiction, violence, hatred, anger, bitterness, rejection, vengefulness. I mean, I became a new creation instantly. Amen.
Amen.
I didn't go through 12 steps. Now, I have nothing against these programs. I'm okay with it. I mean, if it helps people, amen. But I didn't go to 3, 6, 9, 12 steps. No, I just prayed the prayer. I believed that God was God. I believed that what he said was true, and it changed my life.
Amen.
Give Jesus a hand clap. Amen. So, I want to share with you at this point this simple truth. I tell you, as God lives, if you're struggling with anything in your life, nicotine, I smoked ever since I was 6 or 7 years old. Started drinking before that. If you're struggling with nicotine, alcohol, I started using drugs when I was about 9 years old. Drugs. I didn't understand why I didn't have a father, but it wrought all manner of anger and confusion and hatred and just a sense of rejection or abandonment. And I just had this hatred for the world. I could not abide authority of any kind. And unfortunately, my particular anger was coupled with violence. And so I was a very violent young man. And it wasn't just fists, but I went to knives and guns and bricks and bats and anything that you could find to kill people. And but instantly, the Lord broke it. I became a new creation that quickly. So I tell everybody today, if you have problems, if anything, nicotine, alcohol, drug addiction, hatred, bitterness, rejection, violence, it doesn't matter what it is. I know that I know that I know that God can deliver you instantly. You can be free that quickly. But it doesn't stop there. God is infinite. He always goes from strength to strength, from faith to faith, and from glory to glory. You would think that that was utopia for me. You'd think that was eureka in my life, but no, it got better. Then he filled me with his Holy Spirit. At that same moment, he filled me with his Spirit. He gave me my prayer language.
Yes.
Hallelujah. And I found myself with my hands up in the air, worshiping and praising the Lord, using phrases that were foreign to me, things, saying things that I had never said before, like, I love you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. I just began to, and I was weeping. It was just in the throes of weeping and just passionately adoring the Lord Jesus Christ. You may have heard that little adage that says, or that little saying that says that a man with an argument is no match for a man with an experience. I had an experience. Amen. Nobody, I had no religious baggage at all. Nobody had told me about doctrines. Nobody had told me about the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Nobody had told me about tongues. Nobody had told me about any of these things. God just did it. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. And like I said, he always goes from glory to glory. You would think that that was a blessing in itself, and it was, but then it got even better. The Lord caught me up to heaven. I went into the presence of God. And when I was in his presence, I experienced, the life that is God himself. And people have asked me many times, what happened in heaven? Did you see golden streets, or were there any angels there? Did you hear music, harp music? What do they play up there? I don't see any of that. But I can tell you right now, as God lives, what the difference is between heaven and earth. Life. My entire being was saturated with life. I could feel my hair, my elbows, my earlobes, parts in your body that you're not even conscious of cognizantly. But I could feel my entire being just teeming with life. There was it was just everything was alive. Hallelujah. We don't realize that we're surrounded by death. We don't realize that if there's a piece of board, it's dead wood. If you see red, yellow, and orange leaves in the fall, and it looks beautiful, but they're dead leaves. Somebody say amen. Amen. Hallelujah. You see a beautiful wood carving, it's dead wood. You see a beautiful steak sizzling? Anyway. You can scratch that one. Rebecca Senda. Amen. We don't realize that we're surrounded by death in this earth, in this life. In heaven, there is no death. There is no dying, there is no crying, there's no sickness, there's no disease, there's nothing. It's just life. We've never experienced anything like it other than the divine presence of the living God. Amen. Amen. And so I didn't have theological backing for everything that I'm telling you at that point. But I can tell you that I experienced it. Amen. Amen. And I just had a consciousness of eternity. At that point, I was 23 years old, and I knew for the first time, never having thought about life after death, or what's going to happen after it, or what happens from here, or what's next, or anything. I didn't know any of that stuff, and I didn't care. Because I was living life to its fullest. I was pushing drugs. I had more money than I could spend. I had all the drugs that I needed. I was traveling around the world, enjoying life. Just as if you ask me, I was on top of the world. Little did I know that there was more, and there is more. And so, but when I was in heaven, I just realized that there is an eternity. And the word of the Lord tells us in the book of Ecclesiastes chapter 3 that God has set eternity in the hearts of men. Amen. We don't have to argue with people to convince them that there is life after death. Every man, whether he lives in the mountains, in the valleys, in the islands, or wherever it is that he lives, in the jungles, every single human being knows that there is an eternity. Whether they admit it or not, it is irrelevant. The fact is that he has set eternity in our hearts. Somebody say amen. Amen. Hallelujah. I became aware of that. And thirdly, he did an amazing thing for me. And I love to share this because of things that I see when I go around the world preaching the gospel. When I was standing there, I tasted something in my mouth. And what I tasted was this this taste that is indescribable. And when I tasted this in my mouth, I tasted like, it was totally and completely satisfying. But it also had that little quality about it that you couldn't get enough. So, on the one hand, I was completely satisfied, and on the other hand, I wanted more. Little did I know at the time that what God was doing is he was placing a love in my heart for his word. I don't read the word of God for knowledge or for information. It is the bread of life. Amen. Just read it. Just eat it. Just ingest it. Digest it. Hallelujah. And I didn't realize it, but what happened at that moment, that from that moment forward to this day, I will not go to bed at night or wake up in the morning without the Word of God. I do not go throughout the day without thinking about it. The word of the Lord is true. It says, blessed is the man who does not walk in the counsel of the ungodly, nor sits in the seat of the scornful, nor stands in the way of sinners. But his delight is in the law of the Lord. And on it doth he meditate both day and night. Hallelujah. This man does not have to go around begging God for blessings. Because he says that this man will be like a tree planted by the river of living waters. Hallelujah. He will bring forth fruit in due season. His leaf will not wither. Somebody say amen. Amen. And everything that that man does will prosper. We are not beggars. We are sons of the Most High God. Hallelujah. He knows what you need. Hallelujah. And he can get it to you. Somebody say amen. Hallelujah. And so God just planted that in my heart. The reason why I love to share this is for this simple reason. Is because sometimes if we see people that have a certain experience with God, we look at them and kind of we have this wishful thinking is, I wish I could sing like that. I wish I could worship like that. I wish I knew the word like that. I wish I could. No. When you see that, all you have to do is say, Lord, I want that. And he could make you love his word that quickly. Hallelujah. He did it for me. He can deliver you that quickly. Hallelujah. He can set. Listen. I share this because I run into this all over the world. I had a man say to me, well, I prayed for the fullness of the Holy Spirit for years, and I never get it. Well, have you ever read Luke 11:13? Where it says that if we ask him, he'll do it. I showed it to him. I said, now you tell me who's right, you or this word? The word must be true. Amen. The word must come through. Yes. Amen. If we're not receiving a blessing from the Lord, the problem lies elsewhere, not in the word and not in the Lord. Amen. Yes. And so if you see anything that you admire in a brother or a sister or a worship leader or a pastor or a whatever, if you see something, you see them quoting scripture, you see them singing, worshiping God, whatever it is that's admirable about, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are, you know, of a good report, and if there be any virtue, if there be any praise, think on these things. If you see anything like that, all we have to do is say, Lord, do it. I want that now. I want to worship God like that sister worships God. Hallelujah. I want to, Rebecca Shende, amen. And you know, it says in the book of John chapter 15 and verse 7 that if we abide in him and our word, his word abides in us, we will ask what we will and it shall be done unto us. He can do it in you. Amen. And so that's how simple walking with God is. That's how simple living with God is. He will not deny us anything that is good. He will not. Every good and perfect gift comes from the Father above. We do not have to beg him for the food that we eat. We do not have to beg him for a house to live in. We do not have to beg him for, no. If it's a good thing, he gives it to us. Somebody say amen. Amen. Give Jesus a hand clap. And so he filled me with his Holy Spirit. He gave me my prayer language, caught me up to heaven, and he put a calling on my life instantly. And I want to share with you how that happened. And this is, I love this because, you know, there is such a thing as a spirit of religion. Amen. In fact, there's going to be a lot of people in the last days that are going to be ever learning and never coming to the knowledge of the truth. And the way that it works is like this. So I get up off my knees and I'm going back to the pew on which I was sitting. And as I turned around to sit down, I heard the audible voice of the Lord Jesus Christ. I heard his audible voice. I hadn't even been saved 1 hour. But the word of the Lord says that his sheep hear his voice. Amen. Some people would have you believe that you must be a spiritual giant. You must be this, that. No. Adam was in complete transgression when he heard the voice of the Lord in the cool of the day in the garden. He heard it. Balaam was in total opposition to God's known will. But God clearly spoke to him. Amen. We can hear his voice. We have an inherent God-given ability to hear the voice of God. Amen. Amen. Say it with me. I can hear his voice. Amen. That damnable spirit of religion, I was sharing a testimony one time, and this one guy says, you can't say that. Say what? You can't say that you heard God's voice. I said, well, why not? He said, because. like the guy that was talking to me about healing, and he says, I don't believe that God heals today. You can't just pray and ask him to heal you. I said, why not? He says, because. And then I said, have you ever experienced the healing power of God? He said, no. I said, so you don't know what you're talking about. Right? If they've never experienced, they don't know what they're talking about. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Don't let somebody with an argument talk you out of your blessing. Yes. Just receive it. God says that his sheep hears his voice. Hear it. Amen. Amen. I believe that God wants to release you today. He wants to release you into something greater, something more than what you've ever experienced. And I'm going to tell you what the key to that release is. This is what he said to me, and this is what I will say to you. And I say it with full confidence, because I've traveled all over the world, and I've seen people completely delivered from nicotine addiction. I've seen people completely delivered from alcohol addiction. I've seen people completely delivered from drug addiction. I've seen people completely delivered from hatred, bitterness, rejection, religiosity, you name it, and they've been set free instantly. Amen. This is the way release goes. Every child of God that has ever been born again of the Spirit has a desire to go to another level. Somebody say amen. Yes. No truly born again child of God will be satisfied where he is. It is not the nature of life. Life wants to continue, wants to grow, wants to increase, wants to develop, wants to continue on. Only religion chooses to stay dead and stagnant. This is what the Lord said to me, and I heard his voice clear as you can hear mine today. And he said to me, the purpose, quote unquote, the purpose for your life is to serve me. Hallelujah. I had not even been saved 1 hour when I heard his beautiful voice. And I'm going to tell you something. Nothing sounds like his voice. I've heard hundreds of sermons, hundreds of teachings. I've experienced miracles. I've seen miracles. I've been, done, had, and back. But I've never heard anything that sounds like his voice. You want to hear his voice. I'm going to tell you why. The key to intimacy with the Lord is hearing his voice. In the Gospel of John chapter 3 and verse 34, the word of the Lord says this. He whom God has sent speaks God's words. In John 8:47, the word of the Lord says, that they that are of the Lord hear God's word. In John 18:37, there's a little shift that takes place. When the Lord was talking with Pilate, Pilate asked the question, what is truth? The Lord's response was this, listen very carefully. The Lord's response was very simple. He said, they that are of the truth will hear his voice. Amen.
Amen.
What's the difference between John 18:37 and 8:47 or 3:34? Religion versus intimate relationship. God wants to speak. He has given you the ability to hear his voice. In fact, he tells us in Hebrews 3:7, 3:15, and Hebrews 4:7, he says, today, if you hear his voice, amen. God speaks today. He charges us. He declares to all creation. He says, let them that have ears, hallelujah. He's talking to all creation. He's talking to every demon in hell. He's talking to the sun, the moon, and the stars. And he's saying, let them that have ears hear. Sharabaka sanda. Amen. What the Spirit is saying unto the churches. If some people want to stay in their religious thing, it's okay. That's fine. But we don't have to. Because God said, if they want to hear, let them hear. Amen.
Amen.
I heard his voice and he said, the purpose for your, and I'll tell you what your purpose is. You may be a doctor, you may be a lawyer, you may be an architect, you may be a politician. It doesn't matter what you do in life. But I will tell you this. The purpose for doctoring, the purpose for lawyering, the purpose for architecting is to serve God.
Amen.
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 The whole reason why we were born into this life is to serve the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
And so he said to me, the purpose for your life is to serve me. When I heard that audible voice, and this is the other thing, a lot of people think that, you know, that the things of God are just spiritual. And that is true. They are spiritual. But he also gave us senses. And we can experience God with our eyes. We can have visions of the Lord. With our ears, we can hear his audible voice. And the word of the Lord tells us that strong meat belongs unto them who are mature, who through the reason of exercise have their senses, or through the reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil. We can have tangible, manifested experiences with God. He can appear like a Shekinah glory cloud, and we can see it. He can appear as a fragrance. We've had it. We've had the Shekinah glory cloud in our ministry. We've had gold dust manifested in our ministry. We've had the fragrance of the Lord manifested in our ministry. We've had creative miracles manifested in our ministry. And so God is not only a spirit exclusively, but he has made it possible for us to experience him tangibly. We can hear his voice. We can see him. We can hear him. We can taste him like I did. We can smell him.
Amen.
Hallelujah. When I heard his voice, I sensed something within my heart, and it was a physical, tangible sensation. Something shifted within me and fell in place like a gear. And when that happened, I remember that the first thing that happened in my mind and in my heart was this. This is what I've been looking for all of my life. You see, my life was characterized by a terrible disquiet, a dis-ease. I tried sports, tried music, tried partying, tried drugs, tried girls, tried this, tried that, tried the other. Everything that I tried satisfied for a few days, a few weeks maybe. But then there was still that emptiness. And like it was spoken by that great man of God, he said, our hearts are restless, oh God, until they find their rest in thee. At that instant, my heart fell into place, and I had the peace of God. I knew my purpose. I knew the reason for which I was born. And not only that, but I knew that God had a plan for me. And the plan was not for me to be like a little, what do you call those little things that go around in a circle and just run all the time? Yeah. Not to be a hamster. I just sit and run and run and run and run and run and run and run. Never get anywhere. It's not to sit in a wheelchair. It's a lot of activity, but you don't go anywhere. Amen. God has created you. Psalm 8 says this. O Lord, our Lord, how excellent is your name in all the earth. Who hath set thine glory above the heavens. Out of the mouth of babes and sucklings hast thou ordained strength that thou mightest steal the enemy and the avenger. When I look at the heavens, the moon, the stars, the work of your fingers, what is man that thou art mindful of him? Or the son of man that thou visitest him? You made him a little lower than the angels, but you crowned him with glory and honor. And then verse 6 says, you made him to have dominion over the work of your hands. The fish of the sea, the fowl of the air, the beast of the field, everything that moves upon the face of the, this is the purpose for which you were created. Not to be a hamster in a wheel, just running continuously, going nowhere. Not to spend all your life to hoard up goods that you leave for somebody else. No. Serve God. Hallelujah. And it's in hearing his voice. I want to share some scriptures with you. The Gospel of John, chapter 5, verse 39 and 40. And the word of the Lord says, you search the scriptures, thinking that in them you will find eternal life. Yes. But you will not come to me that you might have life. Hallelujah. You know who the Lord was talking to? The Pharisees. Or to us. Ever learning, but never coming to the knowledge of the truth. We love to hear prophets and apostles and see what the latest word for this year is, or the latest word for the next U.S. election, or who's going to win, or who's going to die. When God is saying, come to me. I want you to have life. Hallelujah. God doesn't want us to be going here and there. In fact, he tells us, he says, if they say to you, lo, he is here, or lo, he is there, in a desert place, he says, don't go. He said, the kingdom of God is within you. Amen. God wants to speak to you with his voice. He wants, if you're a parent, if you're a father, if you're a mother, would you be satisfied for somebody to come and give you a message that your son or your daughter sent you? Or would you rather have them come to you and hear their voice? Hallelujah. Amen. No, it's got to be the voice. It's got to be that intimacy. He says, you search the scripture thinking that in them you'll find eternal life, but you will not come to me that you might have life. Hallelujah. How critical is this? And I believe that God is going to release you into something that you've never known before. Amen. It doesn't matter if you've been saved 20, 30, 40 years. I long for this release myself every day. I want this. In the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 28, verse 4, he says this. It shall come to pass that if you hearken unto the voice of the Lord your God, all these blessings will come upon you. And then he goes through a whole slew of blessings. But it's contingent on this one thing. we must hear his voice. Verse 14, he gives us another description. He says, and it shall come to pass that if you do not hearken unto the voice of the Lord your God, then all these things will happen. One of the reasons why we are running to and fro trying to get answers for what's going to happen and when it's going to happen and how it's going to happen and where it's going to happen and who is going to happen and why it's going to happen. No. Mm-mm. God wants us to hear his voice. Amen. He says, today, if you hear his voice. John 18:37, he says this. They that are of the truth. Will hear his voice. But I'm not using the term truth loosely. Three times in the gospel. The phrase spirit of truth is used. One in John 14, John 15, and John 16. The phrase is the spirit of truth. When he, the spirit of truth, is come. You know why this is so critical? Because the spirit of truth will never allow you to believe a false doctrine. The spirit of truth will never allow you to believe a lie. The spirit of truth will never allow you to fall for a deception. The spirit of truth will never cause you to be misled or to believe the wrong thing or to even abide or hear the wrong thing. The spirit of truth will always keep you on the straight and the narrow. The spirit of truth will never allow you to go into something that is going to hurt you or harm you in any way. The spirit of truth is characterized by a number of different things. I'm going to be very quick with you. Number one, John 8:32, and you will know truth. And truth will make you free. There is something about being exposed to the spirit of truth that brings about liberty. You will find yourself that you are being more and more liberated into the glories of God than even you were the day before. It has a liberating quality about it. Hallelujah. You will know truth. And that truth makes you free. Amen. It doesn't set you free. It makes you free. There's a constructive edifying that takes place. You are being built up. And the nature in which you're being built up in is a nature of being free. Free to sing, free to dance, free to shout, free to praise, free to worship, free to see, free to hear, free to understand, free to be able to be what God has created you to be. Hallelujah. Amen. Point number two, John 15:26. When the Spirit of truth has come, he will testify of me. The spirit of truth will always lift up Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God, not the latest doctrine, not the latest fad, not changing the atmosphere in the house to a new color because all the churches are now pink or purple or whatever. No. The spirit of truth will always lift up Jesus Christ. Not a man. I'm going to say that again. Not a man. He will not lift up a denomination. He will not lift up a doctrine. The Spirit of truth will always lift up Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. He will always testify of the Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. In John chapter 16, verses 13 through 17, he says that this is when it gets good, and I believe that this is where God wants to release you to. I have no doubt that you love God. I have no doubt that you're hungry for Him. I have no doubt that this is a desire of your heart. Because everybody that has been born again of the Spirit of God, everybody that has the Spirit of the living God in them has this intrinsic desire. Hallelujah. It says that when the Spirit of truth has come, He will not speak of Himself. I'm not talking to you about an anointing. I'm not talking to you about power. I'm not talking to you about healing. I'm talking about, those are all gifts of the Holy Spirit. When the Spirit of truth comes, He will not speak of Himself. But what He hears, that shall He speak. Did you know that there is a conference in heaven today? God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit are discussing these very days that we're living in today. Hallelujah. Amen. The Holy Spirit hears what is going on in conference in heaven, and He will come and He will reveal it to you. What He hears, that will He show you. Amen. He will come and He will tell you exactly what's going to happen. He'll tell you what you need to know. If you don't have millions in the bank, He may not necessarily talk to you about your investments. You don't need to know that. But if you have a son or a daughter that's not saved, and disaster is about to strike, He will speak to you. If that job that you've applied for is part of God's plan for you, He will tell you. What you need to know, you will be told.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Because we are the children of light, not the children of darkness. Amen. But what He hears, that will He speak. And He will take things that are of the Lord and show them unto you. You won't be taking onto yourself things that are going to be detrimental or harmful to you. You're not going to find yourself ensnared in something that is not of God. He will show you the things that are of the Lord. And then it gets even better than that. He will show you things that are to come. And that's what we need to know. People tell me all the time, is it going to be pre-trib, mid-trib, or post-trib, or pan-trib? The devil has kept the church running around that tree for decades. But in the Gospel of Luke chapter 21 and verse 34, 35, and 36, the Lord says, be sober, be vigilant. That's one of the end time chapters. He said, and pray always. After He told the disciples everything that was going to happen, then at the end He says this, pray. Amen. He doesn't say figure it out. He said pray. Amen. Because He wants us to be in direct communion with Him. He wants you to hear His voice. He wants you not to have to depend on another man. In 1 John chapter 2 and verse 27, He says, the unction which you have received abides in you, and you have no need that any man teach you. But the self-same anointing will teach you all things and is, quote-unquote, true or truth. and it's no lie. And so teachers are good. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Studying is good. It's all good. But they must only confirm what God has already told you in your spirit. If you're not, if it's not confirming to you what you have, it says in that, in those same scriptures of the Spirit of Truth, it says that He will bring to your remembrance everything that I have said unto you. And so when God tells you something, the Spirit of God will bring it to your remembrance. When you hear a teacher say something, or a sermon, or a teaching, or a prophecy, or anything like that, don't sell everything that you've got and go over to another country and find out that there's no country like that. It sounds silly, but it happens. It was a lady that was told that her ministry was going to be bigger than Billy Graham's ministry. So she sold all her property, borrowed money from everybody in the church, and went off to a place and wound up somewhere, and nothing happened. Silly. The Spirit of Truth will not allow that to happen to us. The Spirit of Truth will tell you what you need to know, and He will tell you directly. Why am I saying this? For this reason. Because in this day and age, the most critical thing that we're ever going to be able to get, to have, or to hear is God's voice. Amen. As many as are led by the Spirit of God, not by prophecy, not by doctrine, not by teaching. No. As many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. Amen. Amen. God wants you to hear His voice. He has put it in you to hear His voice. I can guarantee you, as God lives, you take any doctrinal point today, and you will find 15 different books, 15 different ministers with 15 different perspectives. They're all different. How can this be? The thing about the logos and the rhema is this. The logos is the written word. Every one of us have it. The rhema is the spoken word. They will always confirm each other. The logos and the rhema will never contradict each other. They will always be exactly the same. So we must have the Word of God. If we have the Word of God, we condition our mind and our heart and our soul to recognize the rhema when the rhema comes. That's what we want. That's what we need in this day, is to hear God's voice. And God wants you to have that today. It's already in you. Because He said, "My sheep hear my voice." Amen. We don't have to ask for it. It's already intrinsic to our being, to our new man, to our new nature. It's in us to hear His voice. It's in us the desire to hear His voice. So I would encourage every one of you, take the Word of God, look at it, listen to it, smell it, taste it, breathe it, sing it, pray it, meditate on it, do all these things. And when you hear His rhema, when you hear His voice, you'll recognize it that quickly. Amen. Come taste and see that the Lord is good. Did you know that in Israel, they put the Word of God. When the children are little children, They smear the pages with honey. And as the children at that young age are sitting there and they're listening to the Word of God, they're looking at it at the same time, and then they will literally lean forward and lick the page. Because they're being inculcated with a discipline to listen, to look at, to eat it, to taste it. And it's always good because it's honey. So when the word of the Lord says that it's sweeter than honey and the honeycomb, it's talking about those that have taken the time to sit there and listen to the word. We're talking about a time where there was no mass printing. Not everybody had Bibles. They would have to go to the synagogue to hear the word of God read to them, to be quoted, to be spoken. They would sit there and they would listen to it. There was a time when that's all they had. Then they were able to get it in their own hands. Then they would read it, they would quote it, they would sing it. And when they were young, at that very young age, they would lick the pages and they'd taste the honey and it was good. They were in love with God. And after this was inculcated into their being, Charabakasanda, hallelujah, then when they heard God's voice, they recognized it. Because it sounds exactly the same as it looks. It sounds exactly the same as it tastes. It sounds exactly the same as when they sang it and quoted it and spoke it and meditated on it. And it's that split second that the enemy has. If we just question it for a moment, well, I'm not, that's all he needs. That quickly, he'll come in. And he'll inject out, was that God's voice or is that your own flesh? Or is it the devil? In that split second, you've just lost the blessing. Oh, but glorious wonders of God's word when you hear his voice. Like the man in the temple, when he heard the cry of the babe, he knew it was the salvation of Israel. He recognized it. John the Baptist recognized it in his mother's womb. Why? Because we have been given the same benefit. Inside of your spirit, in the innermost sanctum of who you are, you have God-given ability to hear it, to feel it, to experience it, to hear it. Nathaniel came to the Lord. And the Lord said, I saw you when you were under the tree. And he said, my Lord and my God. That's all he heard. I saw you under the tree, my Lord and my God. And the Lord said, because I have said unto thee, I saw thee under the tree. He says, I say to you, verily, verily I say unto you, you will see angels descending and ascending upon the Son of God. Hallelujah. Amen. Believe. Let me tell you, if the easiest and the simplest way to develop the discipline of believing is get his word. Get his word into you. Read it. Hear it. Sing it. Pray it. Quote it. Memorize it. Write it on the tablets of your heart. Hallelujah. That's what he said to Joshua. He said, look at it. Bind it around your neck. Write it on tablets of your heart. Be of good courage. That's where good courage comes from the Word of God. Psalm 119, verse 11, the psalmist said this, Thy word, O Lord, have I hid in my heart, that I might not miss it. Amen. We, every one of us has it. I'm going to ask you to stand up to your feet right now. The native peoples of the Americas came up with a phrase that is now quoted around the world, and it says this, Give me a fish, and I'll eat for a day. Teach me to fish, and I will eat for a lifetime. Did you know that if we develop the ability to hear His voice, we will have a lifetime of blessings. We will have a lifetime of healing experiences. Because Psalm 107 and verse 20 says that He sent His word and healed His people. Proverbs 4:22 says His words are life to them that find them and health to all of their flesh. I'm not talking about an event here. I'm talking about a life-transforming work of God in your heart and in your soul. In the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 3, it says, I know everything that God does is forever. You know that God wants to do something in our hearts today, right now, right here. That is going to last for eternity. Amen. Hallelujah. He's doing something in our hearts, in our souls, in our minds. He's doing something in our life that is going to... Jesus sowed an eternal life when He died on the cross of Calvary. And it was not to reap 80 or 90 years of blessings. It was for us to reap everlasting life. Amen. Hallelujah. You need more than rent money. You need more than a car payment. You need more than the food that you're going to eat today and tomorrow and the next month. You need more than a 40-year career. You need more than a house that's going to burn in 60 years. What we need is we need something that's going to have eternal ramifications in our life. We need something that is going to have eternal ramification in our eternal destiny in Christ Jesus the Lord. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. And the devil wants to seduce you into thinking about the next year or the next, what's the word for next year? No. God wants to have us an eternal perspective. We're living for eternity. We're looking for a city whose builder and maker is God. Hallelujah. We're just passing through. Hallelujah. Shout yes. Amen. We need an eternal God. We need an eternal word. We need everlasting life. That's what we need in our lives. You have no idea how vexing it is to see people and they say, oh, I just bought a house. Big deal. How long is that going to last? How long do cars last these days, Pastor? They're made to last 7 years. You mean to tell me that Jesus Christ sowed an eternal life, an everlasting life, so that we could reap a 7-year benefit or live in a house for 60 years? No! I declare to you that He died, that whoso believes in Him will not die but have everlasting life. Amen. Hallelujah. Give Jesus a hand clap right now. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. My God is an eternal God. He was from everlasting to everlasting. He was before time was, and he will be after time is. Everlasting. And he sold his life, his dear life, his precious life. He shed his immaculate blood, the pure, spotless blood of the Lamb, so that we could have everlasting life. We have cheapened this thing so much that most of us are just wanting to know what the word is for this year. And we don't even care for the program of God. We just want to know for ourselves what to do with our finances, what to do with our Where is the fear of God? Where is our concern for the eternal destiny of souls? You think God is going to put everything that he is into an election that's going to be for 4 years and then again? God is deciding the destiny of nations. God is concerned with the eternal destiny of souls. I was in a place. I met a man that has a movement that spans in the millions. One time he got home, he was so tired. He said to the Lord, "Lord, it's too much. Just take me home. I can't do it." Instantly, he was caught into the presence of God. He found himself standing before this massive throne. He had to crink his neck upward to be able to try to see the top. And he said that around this throne there was thunders and lightning. And as he was looking to comprehend this magnificent sight, then he heard a voice. And the voice said, "Whom shall we send? Who will go for us?" And that man that was so tired that he was desiring just to die and go home to be with the Lord, all of a sudden was filled with life when he heard those words. His hands whipping up in the air, and he shouted into the throne and he said, "Here am I, Lord, send me." And as his voice went into the throne, he was back on his chair. And he's serving the Lord today. He has a movement that is affecting the world. What are we living for? I hope you're just not living for permanent residence or trying to buy a new car or get chrome rims for your motorbike. I realized at that moment that what I had relegated to historical event in Isaiah chapter 6 was the very heartbeat of God today. Why do we want to hear his voice? I'll tell you what he told me again. The purpose for our life is to serve him. Amen. Not my own wants, not my own desires, not my own goals, not my own objectives, not my own selfish ends. No. 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 The purpose for our life is to serve Him. I'm going to ask you to bow your heads right now. If ever I knew that God would grant an answer to a prayer, it's this one. Because He is paining in His heart to speak to you. Not through the pastor, not through the apostle, not through the prophet, to you. He's your Father. Heavenly Father God, right now, in the name of Jesus, we stand before you, Lord. And we call heaven and earth to witness right now. That we want to hear your voice. And I declare according to the word of the Lord that must be fulfilled. I declare that the heavens and the earth will pass away, but the word of God will not pass away. Every jot and every tittle will be fulfilled. And I declare according to this eternal word, let him that hath ears hear what the Spirit is saying unto the church. I'm going to ask you to lift up your hands right now. I believe some of you are going to begin to hear. Some of you are going to begin to have dreams. Some of you are going to begin to have visions. Some of you are going to begin to experience. He's going to bring things to your remembrance. There's things that are going to begin to happen in your life that are supernatural in ramification. And they're not just tickling experiences. They're going to be life-transforming experiences. They're going to make the difference in people's eternal destiny. Could be your family member. It could be your neighbor. It could be a coworker. It could be somebody that you just run into in the streets. But you will speak a word that will change their eternal destiny. Instead of going to hell and burning for eternity, they will go into heaven and rejoice in the divine presence of the living God. Heavenly Father God, I'm asking you right now, in the mighty name of Jesus, open heaven and speak. Right now, in the name of Jesus, we command deaf ears to open. Now! In the mighty name of Jesus. Lord, blind eyes to see. In Jesus' mighty name. Lord, dull hearts to understand your ways. I'm going to count to three and I'm going to invite you to just begin to pray. Begin to pray in the Spirit, and the Lord is going to begin to do this work in you. Here we go. One, two, three. Pray. Pray, 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 pray. Do it, Lord. Do it, Lord. Do it, Lord. In the mighty name of Jesus. We speak to deaf ears and we say, open now in Jesus' mighty name. Pray, pray. Today, if you hear his voice, I declare before heaven and earth, let him that has ears hear what the Spirit is saying unto the church. Right now, in the mighty name of Jesus, we just release in this place. The Spirit of truth. The Spirit of truth that will first testify of the Lord Jesus Christ. That will not speak of himself, but will declare what he hears. That will take those things that are of the Lord and show them unto you. I declare that the Spirit of truth will show you things that are to come. Pray, pray. Right now, Lord, in the mighty name that is above every name, we say yes and amen to your word. Yes and amen. Precious Holy Spirit, to your voice. Oh, Heavenly Father God, right now in the mighty name of Jesus, we come against all confusion. We come against everything that interferes with spiritual hearing. We come against every obstacle in the mighty name of the Lord. Right now, in the name of Jesus. And Lord, I call heaven and earth to witness right now that we're not here, Lord, just for a passing experience. We're not just here for a casual event. We're here, Lord, because we want to have something that is worthy of everlasting life. Something that is worthy of eternal life. Something that is worthy of the immortal Word of God. Something that is worthy of an eternity in heaven, in your presence. I declare to you, as God lives, that it has come to pass that the Lord has poured out His Spirit upon all flesh. Amen. Declare that your sons and your daughters will prophesy. I declare that young men will see visions. I declare that old men will dream dreams. I declare that on His servants and His handmaidens, He will pour out of His Spirit in these days. And I declare to you, as God lives, that God is releasing you even now according to His purposes and His plans for His ends. Right now, in the mighty name of Jesus. Heavenly Father God, I pray that the spirit of wisdom and revelation would come upon us, that the eyes of our understanding will be enlightened, that we will know what is the exceeding greatness of your power to us ward who believe, which you wrought in Christ Jesus, when you raised Him far above all principalities and power and might and dominion and every name that is named. And you made Him to be seated at the right hand of God on high. And you gave Him to be the head over all things to the church, which His body, the fullness of Him that fills all in all. And the Lord would say to you, you have waited long enough, but I say to you, the time has come, and the time is now. You have wanted to serve me, saith the Lord, in healing, go forth. Pray for the sick. You have wanted to serve me in evangelism. Go forth and be a witness unto me. Even now I say to you, cleanse the lepers. And yes, think it not strange that God would even raise someone from the dead. Go forth and raise the dead. For God has not given you the spirit of fear, Say this with me, in the name of Jesus. I declare that God has not given me the spirit of fear. I will not be afraid to pray for the sick. I will not be afraid to witness. I will not be afraid to cleanse lepers. I will not be afraid to raise the dead. In the name of Jesus. Fear, I call you out by name and I command you in the name of Jesus, be gone. Gone now in Jesus' name. And I declare that God has given me the spirit of love. Love that never fails. The spirit of power. Authority over all the power of the devil. And the spirit of a sound mind. I have the mind of Christ. As it is written. So let it be. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen. Amen. Give Jesus a hand clap right now. Why am I so sure? After I got saved in 1978, February the 11th, I went back to the ship on which I was stationed. And I told all my drinking friends, all my drug addict friends, I told all my girlfriends, I don't do those things anymore. Amen. They looked at me and they snickered and they said, it's not going to last. 3 weeks, he'll be back. 3 months, he'll be back. I've been walking with the Lord 41 years. Amen. And it's only getting better. I want to release you right now into your destiny. If you have been risen with Christ and you are seated with Him at the right hand of God, set your affections on the things which are above. Everything down here will take care of itself. Focus on Him. Look on Him. For the things that are from above are eternal. But the things that are from beneath are temporal. God's grace and favor be upon every one of you. Amen. Amen.